So first, just a quick word about midterm grades. I still haven't got through the feedback on all the papers yet. I got a little bit bogged down this weekend, but by the end of this week, that'll be there. As far as your actual grades are concerned, most of you are doing just fine. Those of you who are not doing just fine, if you have below a C in this class right now, it is probably because of missing work. There are a few people who did not turn in portions of assignments. There are a few people who did not turn in several of the homework assignments early in the semester, and that has come back to bite some of you. Now, the ship has sailed on the homework assignments, right? We're done with that. I'm not accepting late assignments as far as that is concerned. So what you need to do then, if you are in that situation, is you need to make sure that you get all the points that you can going forward, right? So you need to make sure, for example, that you do all of the creative writing assignments, right? That'll make up some of the points that you missed by not doing the homework, right? Do as well as you can on the in-class writings, right? Come to me for help with the papers. But yeah, most of you I'm not concerned about. Most of you are doing just fine. Does anybody have any questions about midterm anything? No? All right, then let's talk a little bit about what I want you to do for next time. First, there are three poems that I want you to read. I want you to read Song by Edmund Waller, One Perfect Rose by Dorothy Parker, and The Sick Rose by William Blake. And what we're going to be focusing on next time is imagery and symbolism. So I want you to think about what image is shared between all three poems and whether they all treat this image the same way, right? Does it mean different? Does it mean something different in each of these poems? So I got haikus from most of you. I would like you to vote on those, right? They're in your campus email, as I said before class started. I'd like you to vote on those by sometime this evening. And so we'll have a winner by the time we meet for class on Wednesday, right? How'd that go for you? What'd you think of the process of writing the haikus? Did you find it difficult? Did you find it easy? Pardon?
I don't know. But at first I thought it was like 5 words.
Okay. So right, the question of, you know, how many of you had trouble distinguishing between a word and a syllable? Okay. At least a couple of you did, right? So we all know, right, that the syllables are just the basic units of sound in a word, right? Not the word itself. You know, several words are one syllable, right? Lamb, right? Little, London, two syllables. Right. This is going to be important. This is going to matter a lot more, actually, for what we're going to get into talking about today. Did any of you have any difficulty with this other than just counting syllables, or did you find most of you find it to be pretty easy?
I'm not sure the ideas work. I had trouble structuring those ideas, so yeah, I had a bit of trouble with that.
So you had a little bit of trouble, like, fitting an idea into that small space? And figuring out how to convey what you wanted to in just 3 lines. Yeah, I mean, haiku is an art form that depends very much on concentration on a single image. And so you have to try to keep your idea very, very small, very, very narrow in order for it to work. What I'd like you to do for next time, you're going to try something a little bit more complicated. You're going to write an Anglo-Saxon riddle poem. This is actually sort of going back to one of the earliest forms of English language poetry. So your poem for next time can be 4 to 6 lines. It should also not rhyme. Anglo-Saxon, that is Old English poetry, never rhymes. The lines can be any length you want, but each line must include 3 stressed syllables that alliterate with each other. First off, does everybody know what I mean by alliteration? Does everyone know what alliteration is? Okay, this is when the sound at the beginning of a syllable repeats, right? So these three that I've got up here, right, lamb, little, London, these all alliterate with each other. Now, to make this a little bit easier, according to Anglo-Saxon poetic rules, all vowels are regarded as alliterating with each other. So A alliterates with E, O, I, U, whatever, right? Does everybody understand what I mean by stressed syllables? Since I know we didn't have time to go over that last time. Okay, the stressed syllable is the syllable in a word that you say louder or more forcefully than the other, right? So lamb is one syllable, right? So that's what's stressed. What about little? Which syllable do I say more loudly? Little. Lit, yeah, so that would be the stressed syllable, right? Toll would be the unstressed, right? London, same thing. I say London more loudly. That's the stressed syllable, that's the unstressed syllable, right? We use the little hash mark here to indicate a stressed syllable, and this little sort of U thing to indicate an unstressed syllable. So each line of your poem needs to include three stressed syllables that alliterate with each other. There can be more than three stressed syllables, but three stressed syllables have to alliterate with one another.
In every single line.
In every line, yep. And the topic, right, you're going to be describing an object without naming it, right? So, you know, don't be too obscure, but try to be clever, right? The point is for someone else to guess what it is you're talking about. Right, so don't tell me what it is either, because I would also like the opportunity to try to guess. Does anybody have any questions about this? Yeah, Macy.
This is the Wednesday.
This is for Wednesday, yeah. And it goes in the same folder. All of these are going to go in that creative writing folder. So the reason I want you to do this, right? Haiku is an example of what we call syllabic verse. Syllabic verse, the rhythm depends solely on counting syllables. All that matters is the number of syllables. Most Japanese poetry works this way. Most French poetry also works this way. All that matters is the number of syllables in the line. That's coming from outside, right? Mm-hmm. Hold on a second. Video. All right. Where was I? Syllabic verse, right? Okay, so Anglo-Saxon poetry is an example of what's called accentual verse, in which the rhythm is dependent on the number of stresses the line, and that's it. It doesn't matter how long the line is, how many syllables total. So these are two different approaches to poetic rhythm. Now, most contemporary English language poetry is what we call accentual syllabic, which means that both the number of syllables and the number of stresses in the line matter when you're measuring the rhythm. We'll talk a little bit more about how to measure rhythm in a line in a little while. But I just want you thinking about these issues while you're writing this particular poem. So, that said, one last thing I want to quickly go over before we start talking about today's poems. I want to talk to you a little bit about paper two. But you know, don't freak out, it's not due that soon. But I want to make sure you're aware of it and that you have, you know, time to consider what it is you want to do for this. So the draft for this paper is going to be due on Monday the 20th, so you have 2 weeks. The paper itself is going to be due on the 27th. And what you're going to do is choose one of the poems that is on the syllabus, whether we've talked about it in class or not, right? So, you know, there are a couple of poems that I've assigned for you to read, right, that we didn't have time to talk about. You can still write about those if you want to. You can also write about poems that we did talk about. And you're going to choose some feature or pattern in the poem to make an argument about, right? Much like paper one. This paper is going to be a little bit shorter. It's 1,500 to 1,800 words rather than 2,000 to 2,500, since you're dealing with a smaller amount of material. But otherwise, the process is pretty much the same, right? You choose something that you think is interesting or meaningful in the poem, and you make an argument as to why that thing is interesting or meaningful. So here's what I would suggest you do with this. First, you want to make sure that you understand the poem on a surface literal level, right? So maybe your second paragraph after the introduction should be devoted to a brief summary of what you think is going on in the poem. And then from there, you move into picking apart the literary devices you see in the poem, right? How does it use rhyme to evoke meaning? How does it use particular symbols to evoke meaning? How does it use meter to evoke meaning? Right? Be as specific about things as possible. For example, do not just say that a poem is about love, right? Don't talk in terms of fuzzy emotions. If you think the poem is about love, then I want to know, one, what kind of love is it about, right? Is this successful, happy love? Is this unrequited love? Right? Who are the people involved? Do they both appear in the poem? Right? Place it in as full a situation as is possible. And then you're going to want to look at formal devices and word choice in the poem, rhyme scheme, meter, things of that nature. Are there things in the language or structure of the poem that hinted a meaning other than the surface meaning? So one of the things we're going to try to get to today is how to use meter and rhyme to locate places where the poem tends to undercut its own surface meaning, right? Where the rhyme scheme and the meter may actually either reinforce or push against what the poem appears to mean. All right, so does anybody have any questions about this? You will still, by the way, get credit for going to the Writing Center. And remember that, you know, you have the break to work on this. So, anything?
Okay, you wanted to talk about literary devices?
Yeah.
How does that go in with the argument?
Well, you're using those to determine what you think the poem means, right? So, remember when we talked about the flea last time? Yeah. You know, we have this, you know, male speaker trying to bend a female listener to his will. And all of those rhymes, right, are these single stressed syllable masculine rhymes, right? So the rhyme scheme backs up the male speaker and the viewpoint of the male speaker, right? We could also look at sort of the more general rhyme scheme there. You got the three couplets and then the three, you know, then the tercets at the end of each stanza, right? Just the way the rhyme scheme is set up is in twos and threes, twos and threes, twos and threes, right? Me plus you, me plus you, me plus you, me plus you plus flea, right? So what you want to do is look at the way those sorts of things reflect the meaning of the poem. And if you're having trouble with this, right, then, right, come and talk to me and we'll work through it. Any other questions?
No.
All right, then let's start today with Aunt Jennifer's Tigers by Adrienne Rich. So if you have the green book, that is on page 550. If you have the red book, it is on
801.
Thank you, Ian. So once everybody's there, can I get a volunteer to read this?
Aunt Jennifer's...
Oh. Yeah, go ahead. You got there first.
Okay. Aunt Jennifer's tigers prance across the screen. Bright topaz, denizens of a world of green. They do not fear the men beneath the tree. They pace with sleek, chivalric certainty. On Jennifer's finger, fluttering through her wool, find even the ivory needle hard to pull. The massive weight of Uncle's wedding band sits heavily upon Aunt Jennifer's hand. When Aunt is dead, her terrified hands will lie, still ringed with ordeals she was mastered by. The tigers in the panel that she made will go on prancing, proud and afraid.
Okay, thank you. So, what do you think this poem is about? What do you think is going on in this poem?
I think she got killed by her tigers.
You think she got killed by her tigers?
Yeah.
Why do you think she got killed by her tigers?
Because it's talking about her terrified hands will lie, and then the tigers still prancing and nothing happened.
Okay. What do you think, Frank?
It seems to me it keeps going back to this a wedding band, massive weight of a wedding band, for terrified hands alive.
Is it the
she got trapped in a marriage?
Yeah, is it the tigers that she seems to be afraid of, actually? It's right.
They do not fear
uncle,
the men
right?
beneath the mm-hmm. tree.
So she's talking about like her husband.
Seems to be that way, right? What are the tigers? Are the tigers real tigers?
No.
Yeah. Pardon? I can't hear you.
Are going against just imagination.
Yeah. What's she doing to make the tigers?
Yeah.
It's embroidery. Yeah. She's exactly. They're embroidery tigers. So the tigers are just a picture that she makes on a screen of cloth, right? So Aunt Jennifer's tigers prance across the screen, bright topaz denizens of a world of green. Now, can embroidered tigers actually prance? So any movements that we see in the tigers, right? Well, let's think about the kind of movement actually that's described here first, right? Look at any movement words there in the first stanza. What words here indicate movement or some kind of movement?
Prance.
Prance, okay, good.
Pace. Fluttering.
Let's just stick with the first stanza for now. So the tigers prance and pace, right? Now remember too, right, these words alliterate with each other, right? Repeated sounds indicate connected ideas, right? Prance and pace. Any other words that like don't describe movement specifically but are related to movement that we see in that first?
The tree?
Sleep, right? What do we associate with something that's sleek?
Smooth.
Pardon?
Like smooth.
Yeah, smooth, easy, right? So these tigers just look like they're kind of gliding fluidly across this screen, right? Smooth movements, nothing in their way, certain of themselves, right? Isn't it damn good to be a tiger? But, as we were getting to a moment ago, right, because they're embroidery tigers, they're not real, right? And they can't move. So what does that tell us about all this prance, all this sleek prancing and pacing, all this certainty?
She's imagining.
Yeah, it's all imaginary, right? It's just illusion, it's just a picture. Right. If it looks like the tigers are moving, it's just because of her skillful embroidery. They're not really moving. Now then, if we look at the, if we compare the movement words that we see in the second stanza, which Frank was starting to do, getting ahead of ourselves, right? What movement words do we see in the second stanza?
Fluttering.
Fluttering, good.
Sits.
What else? What other words indicate some kind of movement?
Hard to
pull. Pull. Any others? Anything else that to you suggests movement or a descriptor of movements?
I thought massive weight, but I'm not sure.
Okay, massive weight. So what's happened to the sleek certainty in the first stanza, right? When we move outward from the embroidery screen she's working on to Aunt Jennifer herself. How do we see Aunt Jennifer herself moving?
Slow.
Slow, okay, yeah. She finds even the ivory needle hard to pull, right? What other movement descriptors are applied to her hands? Fluttering, yeah. So if your hands are fluttering, right, what emotional state?
Scared.
Shock.
Yeah, scared, nervous, anxious, right? Right, so her fingers are fluttering through her wool. Finds even the ivory needle hard to pull. The massive weight of Uncle's wedding band sits heavily upon Aunt Jennifer's hand. So why does she find the ivory needle hard to pull?
The weight of the ring.
The weight of the ring on her hand, right? Now, do we see any movement, just to follow up this particular theme, in stanza 3? Okay, prancing again. Prancing proud, right? We have an alliteration there as well. Prancing proud. Any other words related to movement here? Or to the total lack of it.
Lies.
Yeah, lie. Okay, yeah. When Aunt is dead, her terrified hands will lie. Still ringed with ordeals she was mastered by. So what image do we see repeating here again? Why? Her terrified hands will lie. Right, still ring, much like Uncle's wedding band. The tigers in the panel that she made will go on prancing, proud and unafraid. So when poor Aunt Jennifer goes to her final rest, right, her terrified hands stop fluttering. She doesn't have to fear Uncle anymore. The tigers in her picture will go on looking confident, looking sleek, looking happy, right? making everything, making it look like everything's okay.
Everything's great, really.
Okay, so I think those of you who thought that the poem was about a physically or psychologically abusive relationship, yeah, I think that, yeah, that's what's going on here, right? There are other ways here that, well, the central image of that, right, is the band, the wedding band, the ring, and the association of that with heavy weights, with mastery, right? How else might a ring be related to the central activity here, though? What is it Aunt Jennifer does?
She knits.
Yeah, embroidery, right? And you do that, like you make your embroidery fixtures in a little hoop, right? You put the hoop on your knees and you sew the little tigers, whatnot, within the hoop. So everything that she's doing, even her little artwork, is contained within a ring. Now, what do we notice about Uncle here in the poem?
He's not here.
Pardon?
He's not around. He's not with her.
I think he's dead.
You think he's dead? Why do you think Uncle is dead?
Because she didn't really talk about him throughout, or the poem didn't really talk about him, and
he might not be nice.
Pardon?
He might be mean or whatever. But he was talking about like the massive weight of his wedding band. Mm-hmm. So I thought like the tiger was like him, like being proud and stuff, and she was just like in the marriage, like talking about the weight wasn't like the marriage and stuff.
The tigers in the screen are a contrast to her life outside of it, right? Yeah, and I think, yeah, you're right here about the relationship with Uncle here being a bad one, right? Mm-hmm. So let's compare just the way these two characters are named within the poem, right? What's the difference here between Aunt Jennifer and Uncle?
Aunt Jennifer is given a name.
Yeah. Aunt Jennifer has a personal name. Right, Uncle is just Uncle. Right, he's just kind of left this like abstract male figure. Right, he's not Uncle Bob, he's not Uncle Steve, he's not Uncle Joe, he's just Uncle. As though he's sort of like a stand-in for all uncles, right? So you could extend the idea of the poem outward to a kind of criticism of traditional marriage generally, right? Not just Aunt Jennifer's own marriage, but that Aunt Jennifer is just one specific case in a more general field, right? That there are lots of uncles out there doing exactly the same thing to their wives. And this is one of the places where I think, again, looking at the rhyme scheme of the poem might help us. Right, so can you just have a quick look through? Tell me what the rhyme scheme is here. A-A-A-A. Somebody said A-A-A-A. Who said A-A-A-A? Tola, why do you think it's A-A-A-A?
Because it's the way it was called, emphasized, or I said, screen, mm-hmm. Green, tree, certainly, or certainty.
Yeah.
So I just thought.
The vowel sound repeats through the whole stanza, right? So yeah, what we have, right, AA, and let's call him A1, A1. Right. this couplet is an assonance rhyme with this couplet, right? The vowel sound repeats. So there's a kind of harmony in all the vowel sounds in the first stanza. Yeah.
So when we start, I said writing about, we can like include the rhymes in it.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. So then, tell me about the second stanza. What do we have in the second stanza? Let's move to a new letter. Right?
A, B, C, D, D.
Okay. Or well, yeah. Let's go with B, B, C, C. Right. And you notice anything about the B rhyme here?
It's also as much like stress on the vowel.
Yeah, it's not quite perfect, right?
It's not like a U O U
O. Yeah, wool and pull. They're really close, right? But it's not quite a perfect rhyme. Right, and this is where we see that first hint of trouble coming into the poem, right? This is where Aunt Jennifer's fingers are fluttering through her wool. She finds the ivory needle hard to pull. And then the true rhymes, ban, hand, bring order back into the poem. And what about the final stanza?
D-D-E.
Yep. So with the exception of the first stanza, the whole poem is in these kind of unmatched couplets. Right, we have a different pair of couplets, right? Couplets that don't rhyme with each other in each stanza. Right, and couplets, we may remember from talking about the flea, are often used to indicate close human relationships within the poem. Right, the formation of couples, romantic or sexual relationships. So what we have here is a relationship that's probably not entirely harmonious. And by doing one more little thing with the rhyme scheme here, we can, I think, sort of place the weight of responsibility on one party or another. What kind of, when we talked about masculine and feminine rhyme, do you remember what the difference was between the two?
Masculine is like shorter.
Masculine and the word
Yeah. Yeah, a masculine rhyme ends on a single stressed syllable, right? So, can, man. A feminine rhyme rhymes a stressed followed by an unstressed syllable. So, little, spittle. So, what do we have here throughout this poem? Do we have masculine or feminine rhymes at the end of these lines? Yeah. These are all simple, single-stressed masculine rhymes, right? So, the weight of this relationship is coming entirely from one side, or the weight of the relationship is coming from Uncle's side. Uncle has all of the power. Right, even the sound of the poem is basically masculine. Right, so there's one other thing I want to do. Oh yeah, as far as the speaker in the poem is concerned, what can we tell about the speaker? Where do we think the speaker's sympathies lie?
Yeah,
Okay, why do you think the speaker's sympathies lie with Aunt Jennifer? The speaker is not Aunt Jennifer, right? Is someone else describing her. The speaker is...
They named Jennifer and the uncle.
Yeah, the fact that Aunt Jennifer is named and uncle is not indicates greater sympathy with Aunt Jennifer. And also just the simple fact that, yeah, I mean, pardon?
Like, they describe the description and stuff. They don't really describe, like, the uncle, just like that and stuff.
Yeah, that the uncle is relayed mostly through symbols, right? Mostly through his sort of master symbol of the ring. Whereas Aunt Jennifer we see as, you know, a human being sitting, looking scared, embroidering tigers in a ring. Okay, so does anybody have any questions about this poem or any further comments they want to make about this poem? Before we move on to something else. Yeah, Kayla.
Sorry, I was on my head.
Oh, okay. Okay, so before we talk about, I want to briefly look at London by William Blake as well. On page 554 in the Green Book. What I'd like you to do with this is take a minute with the first stanza, just read out each line quietly to yourself, and I want you to, one, count the number of syllables in the line. And two, think about which syllables should be stressed, right? Which syllables, if you speak it out loud a little bit, sound a little bit louder or more forceful to you. So just take a couple minutes with just the first stanza of the poem and see what you can come up with. So how many syllables do we have in each line?
18.
Is that true for all four of these lines?
No. The last one's 7.
Yeah, the last one is the last one cuts off early,
yeah.
Right? So yeah, we have 8, 8, 8, and 7. All right, so let's see if we can figure out a stress pattern for each of these lines, right? I wander through each chartered street. I wander. What about I? Do we stress I or not stress it?
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about this, so.
Yeah. I wander, yeah. I should be stressed. What about wander?
Yeah, I feel like it doesn't know exactly what you mean.
Through each.
No.
Yeah, both of these unstressed, right?
Yeah.
We just kind of glide over these. One general rule of thumb when you're looking at whether or not to stress a syllable, right? If it is noun, pronoun, single syllable, verb, or noun or adjective, then you're generally going to stress it. If it's, you know, prepositions, conjunctions, linking words of various kinds, those you will usually not stress. So I wander through each chartered streets. Chartered. Street. Yep, we stress street. Okay. So what we do when we have got a stress pattern for the line, right, we divide it up into what are called feet. Feet are units of syllables in a line. So because this is an 8-syllable line, right, it makes sense to divide this up into feet of 2 syllables. There are 4 kinds. What the hell was the eraser? Of 2-syllable feet. And they're used for different kinds of effects. And IAM is what's called a rising meter. And IAM is an unstressed syllable followed by a stressed syllable. So the rhythm of the line goes up, right? Hence rising. The opposite of an IAM is called a troche. A troche is called a falling meter because it is a stressed syllable followed by an unstressed syllable, right? The sound of the line sort of goes down. There are also 2 sort of what we call special feet. A spondee is 2 stressed syllables together. This usually indicates an area of special emphasis, right? So for example, the flea. Mark but this flea is 2 spondees together. The guy is trying to get your attention. Say, hey, focus your attention right now at this moment on this flea as forcefully as possible. And the second kind of special foot we call a pyrrhic, and that's 2 unstressed syllables. Right. So your eye and your ear tend to kind of glide over a pyrrhic, right? More stressed syllables will weight down and slow down a line. More unstressed syllables will speed it up. So let's look at what we have here in this first line. What's this first foot?
Spondee.
Yeah, that's a spondee. And it's followed by a pyrrhic, yep. And then what about these last 2? Yeah, these are both IAMs. So try figuring out the second line here. near where the Charter Thames does flow. Okay. Near where? Okay. The Char?
I am.
Good. Turd Thames?
I am.
Yep, another I am. Does flow?
I think there's I think it's my fury.
Yeah, you stress both of these. Does flow. Right? A verb and, well, actually, it's the whole thing is a verb, right? Near where the Charter Thames does flow. So, think about what this line is describing here, right? What's the Thames?
The river.
Yeah, it's the river that flows through London, right? The main river that flows through London. So, this line is describing the motion of a river. And yet, you would expect a line that describes the motion of a river to be sort of very fluid, right? To be sort of fast moving. And does this line move quickly? Is this a light fluid kind of line? This is really heavy, right? It's a heavy, choppy, slow rhythm, exactly. And we have the, you know, three stressed syllables at the end stopping up the flowing of the river. So the rhythm of the line cuts against the idea that the river flows smoothly or easily. And mark in every face I meet. And mark. And mark.
I think it's
fine. This is an I am. Yeah, you generally are not going to stress a conjunction. In ev, this is another I am, good. Reface, I meet. Yep, that's another spawning. So, in general, thus far, the bulk of the poem seems to be what? What seems to be the most common foot in the poem?
I am being spondy.
Mostly, yeah. Mostly iams. There are a lot of spondies as well, right? So an I am is a rising meter. So most of the poem up to this point is building up to something, right? Building up momentum. Which the spondees slow down. Right, so the motion of the walker in the city, the motion of the river, it's supposed to be building to something, but something keeps getting in its way. Now, if we look at this last line, this incomplete line, right? What's the first mark of weakness, mark of woe we see in it? When we compare it to the other lines.
It's shorter.
Yeah, it's shorter. So that's a that's the mark of weakness there, right? This line is not as long as the others. The rhythm, we'll notice, is also different. Marks of weakness, marks of woe. Yeah. Up until that last single stressed syllable, this line is all trochees. So all of this momentum, interrupted though it may be, builds us up to a falling rhythm to disappointments. The speaker's experience of the city is ultimately disappointing. Right? All he sees around him are these marks of weakness, marks of woe. So, let's proceed into the second stanza here and see if this remains consistent, right? In every cry of every man, in every infant's cry of fear, in every voice, in every ban, the mind-forged manacles I hear. Pardon? In every cry of every man, in every infant's cry of fear, in every voice, in every ban, the mind-forged manacles I hear. So we have a complete stanza this time, right? But what's completed in this second stanza? We talk about mind-forged manacles. What do we associate with manacles?
Prisons.
Yeah. Right. It's complete, all right. It's a complete trap. It's a complete prison. How the chimney sweeper's cry every blackening church appalls, and the hapless soldier's sigh runs in blood down palace walls. Runs in blood down palace walls. Right? So we seem to have an alternating pattern here in the last lines, where you'll have a 7-syllable final line in the stanza, then an 8-syllable line in the last stanza, and then a 7-syllable line, right? Complete, incomplete, complete, incomplete. Now, does there seem to be something incomplete in this third stanza to you, if we look at the imagery? How the chimney sweeper's cry every blackening church appalls, and the hapless soldier's sigh runs in blood down palace walls.
You mean like, is it AAA or?
I'm not even talking about the rhyme here, right? We're just trying to associate the imagery with changes in rhythm. What's he reminding us of here by referencing, on the one hand, the church and the palace?
Institutions of state.
Okay, yeah, these are institutions of state. And the chimney sweepers and the hapless soldiers.
Those are the poor people's society.
And how do these people relate to these institutions of state? How is the palace, for example, supported?
It has to be built on the soldiers.
Yep. The hapless soldier's sigh runs in blood down palace walls, right? The labor of the poor, the labor of the average person, props up the wealthy institutions of state. Right, so these institutions are incomplete in themselves and need the chimney sweepers and the soldiers to keep sacrificing, to keep them running. But most through midnight streets I hear how the youthful harlot's curse blasts the newborn infant's tear and blights with plagues the marriage hearse. What do you think of this? Is there anything in this stanza that seems weird to you? Blast the newborn, okay, how the youthful harlot's curse blasts the newborn infant's tear. So we've got, right, harlot, infant. Does anybody know what the harlot's curse is? Syphilis. Yeah, in the 18th and 19th centuries, London was one of the syphilis capitals of the world. So, the harlot's curse, syphilis, blights the life of the newborn infant from the very beginning. Right, children being born with syphilis, what's called tertiary syphilis, and blights with plagues the marriage hearse. What's a hearse? Yeah. Yeah, you use a hearse, right? Not for a marriage typically, but for a funeral, right? Unless you have a very bizarre and gothy sensibility, right? You know, if everybody in your wedding party is wearing white pancake makeup and black velour, maybe you want a marriage hearse, but otherwise, you don't typically associate these things with each other. All right, so this idea of sort of coupling and death in the city, or even this institution of marriage is infected here by plague, by death. So what we have here is this is not exactly a positive conception of the city of London, right? Yeah, I mean, you know, it's dirty, it's smelly, and it's essentially a prison where people die of horrible diseases to prop up empires. So we're about out of time, so we're going to end with that. Please make sure that you turn in your in-class writings. We're going to be looking at those other three poems for next time. Remember to do the Anglo-Saxon poem and submit it to the creative writing folder. Yes, Tora.
Since my school, I couldn't turn it in on Georgia View because Georgia View was down when I tried to send it. Should I still send it?
Yeah, yes. You should still put it in Georgia View just so that I have them all of them in one place when I'm counting for grade.
Georgia View was working on.
Was it on Friday? No.